In January 1964, the BBC saw that for the first time ever, the national singles chart was overflowing with British acts. Due to this, they created a weekly music chart rundown program called Top of the Pops. From then on, every Thursday evening, Britain's youth would be delighted by the latest UK chart goings-on, it being the only place to see their favourite artists and discover exciting new ones. The presenters were cheesy at best, and most of the time, the band had to mime their songs. But some of these performances would embed themselves unshakably into the public consciousness, inspiring generations of bands and artists in their wake, hoping that they too could get their 3 minutes of Top of the Pops glory. From Bowie to Soft Cell, The Smiths to Blur, these are 12 iconic Top of the Pops performances that forever altered British music.
Get up in the morning, slaving for bread, sir.
Due to the BBC's policy to wipe and reuse tapes as a cost-saving measure, the majority of iconic performances from the first decade of Top of the Pops are lost to time. One such pivotal performance was in March 1969, when Desmond Dekker exposed a significant portion of Britain to reggae music with his number one single, Israelites. Dressed in a sharp white suit, Dekker bopped to the syncopated Jamaican rhythm as he told his story of everyday hardships in his thick island patois. Impenetrable to the white British population of the time, but undeniably catchy all the same.
The Israelites, the hits, you know, that was my introduction to reggae. You know, I was fascinated about how do you play it. Even as early as that, I had the idea of merging rock music with reggae music and finding some sort of middle ground.
For the Caribbean immigrant population, it was a rare early chance to see their culture celebrated on 60s primetime television. Dave and Ansel Collins, Bob Marley and Althea and Donna would appear later. But some of those kids that saw Dekker on Top of the Pops would make up the first wave of British reggae and two-tone groups. Glam rock was a genre made for Top of the Pops, literally. In March 1971, before T-Rex's Mark Bolan was about to debut on the show with Hot Love, he splashed some glitter on his face in an attempt to stand out, and unwittingly sparked a revolution. Various shiny, silver-suited performances from Sweet, Slade, and Roxy Music would follow. But if glam rock can be summed up in one 3.5 minute clip, it would be David Bowie's Starman. Before his Top of the Pops reintroduction, Bowie was a one-hit wonder, the curly-haired lost astronaut of novelty folk ballad Space Oddity, from back in 1969. This is ground control to Major Tom. And as canonical as his 1971 album Hunky Dory is now, neither the album nor any of its singles had charted on release. But in July 1972, he was no longer Major Tom. Now with striking makeup, red hair, and a multicolored quilted suit, he was Ziggy Stardust, the out-of-this-world rock star of Bowie's dreams, a dazzling mix of Mark Bolan, Vince Taylor, and A Clockwork Orange. And on Top of the Pops, backed by the Spiders from Mars, was when Britain at large laid their enraptured eyes on him for the first time.
Didn't know what time it was and the lights were low.
The show had been broadcast in colour from November 1969, but it wasn't until Starman that the full spectrum was utilised. As perfect a pop song as it is, as sweetly strums self-mythology into a skyrocketing chorus, it wasn't the focus.
There's a Starman waiting in the sky.
Remembered Spiders from Mars drummer Mick Woody Woodmansey Appearing on Top of the Pops was like reaching the summit of Everest. I recall waiting to go on, standing in the corridor, and Status Quo were opposite us. We were dressed in our clothes and they had on their trademark denim. Francis Rossi looked at me and said, "Shit, you make us feel old." The key slyly revolutionary moment was Bowie and guitarist Mick Ronson singing into the microphone together, Bowie lovingly draping his arm around his guitarist. For terminally repressed 1970s Britain, the image of two flamboyantly dressed men embracing was too much for mainstream society to handle. But for those that saw themselves in that knowing gesture, it would be a much needed lifeline. I just couldn't believe how striking he was. That ambiguous sexuality was so bold and futuristic. They made the traditional male-female roleplay thing seem so outdated. He was tearing down all the old cliches, but he was also having a lot of fun doing it. When Bowie sang the words, "I had to phone someone, so I picked on you," he pointed through the television screen to the viewer at home, inviting the weirdos of Britain into his world, and so many took up that spiritual offer. Punks had a love-hate relationship with Top of the Pops. Though managing 14 top 40 singles in their lifespan, and a number one after they'd split, The Clash vowed never to appear. You know, it's absolutely self-defeating the way The Clash refuse to go on Top of the Pops. Sure, it's a really crummy program, but it's the only one there is. And I know for a fact that every Thursday night, Mick Jones is glued to his TV set. However, bands like The Stranglers and Buzzcocks were less picky, appearing whenever possible, realizing it was the best way to gain exposure, climb the chart, and recruit new members to the punk cause. Whatever happened to all of the heroes? Don't wanna end up like the 9 day wonder. The young Paul Weller remembered seeing Small Faces play the program back in the 60s, and ever since had aspired to do the same. Punk credibility be damned. The Jam would play the show numerous times, but it was their first in skinny ties and suits playing in the city in May 1977. That would be the most impactful, as they were the first punk group on the BBC stage. It helped that the song itself was a youthful anthem, thrilled by the scene developing just out of reach. I was probably 18, so it was a young man's song, a suburbanite dreaming of the delights of London and the excitement of the city. It was an exciting time to be alive. London was coming out of its post-hippie days, and there was a new generation taking over.
Right at the forefront of a new rock phenomenon known as New Wave, they go the Jam and In the City.
The British youth might have seen the Pistols' Steve Jones swearing on Today with Bill Grundy, but the actual music wasn't getting played on the radio. The Jam on Top of the Pops was the nation's first exposure to punk music, which along with performances by The Stranglers, Buzzcocks, and showing the music video for Pretty Vacant in July 77, inspired this new generation to get excited and take up guitars. This is the sound, this is the sound of the summons. Well, anxiety. Babylon's burning, Babylon's burning. That's right, that's right. That's right, that's right. But it wasn't just punks, but also the next era too, the then children of 90s Britpop. New York New Wavers Blondie would be a regular but much needed counterpoint to the syrupy balladeers and reductive dance troupes that formed the majority of female presence on late 70s Top of the Pops. Even jet-lagged, singer Debbie Harry fronted her band with icy cool poise and impeccable fashion sense. While their note-perfect power pop was how they climbed the charts and earned their place on the show, some girls saw Harry's glamorous presence amongst an overwhelming glut of male-stuffed rock bands and realized that rock stardom might be possible for them as well. I'll never forget the first time I saw Blondie on Top of the Pops, and Debbie Harry wearing that black and white striped dress. Something fizzed and popped in my brain. I must have been around 11 years old, thinking, I want to do that. Whatever that was, I had no idea. I just knew I wanted to do what Blondie was doing, but my way. Despite not yet being in the top 40, Gary Numan fluked his way onto the show via their Bubbling Under section in May 1979, his group Tubeway Army being chosen over Simple Minds due to supposedly having a more interesting sounding band name. Another disciple of Bowie, Numan knew how to make his presence felt as he performed Our Friends Electric. Asking the lighting technicians if they could light him from below to give arresting shadows, and singing to the camera on certain lines for emphasis.
So now I'm alone. Now I can think for myself.
However, much of his onstage look was accidental. To cover up a breakout of acne, the makeup women covered his face with white foundation, while his robotic movements were a combination of awkwardness and trying to hide his supposedly big front teeth. The result was an icy-skinned, emotionless cyborg that suited his futuristic synth-based song perfectly, forcing it further up the charts to number one. Synth-pop bands would bring a new sonic palette to the mainstream. However, this newfangled technology was initially misunderstood by many as a musical shortcut.
The Musicians Union, for about a year or two, tried to ban me. Because he said I was putting proper musicians out of work. How offensive is that? The thing is, if I had people that are doing like strings, you know, which a real person could have played, I'd have had some sympathy for what they were saying. I was making synthesizers go, eh, you know, show me a man in the union that goes, eh, for a living, and I'm putting him out of work. I don't think so.
As the 1980s started, more synth-based bands with moody auras would emerge. Yet the pop group most clearly borrowing from Numan weren't even born in 1979. Before Top of the Pops, Soft Cell were experimental provocateurs, a product of Bowie, punk, and throbbing gristle. Nevertheless, their cover of an old, mostly forgotten American R&B B-side, with its mimetic Bink Bink Hook, would secure them a slot in front of the nation's impressionable youth.
Sometimes I feel I've got to run away.
Ever since first seeing Bolan on the show as a boy, obsessed to the extent of stealing the spelling of his first name, Mark Almond's life ambition had been to be himself on Top of the Pops.
This tainted love you've given, I give you all a boy could give you.
With black eyeliner, studded wristbands, and two full arms worth of bangles, the singer wildly emoted his way across the screen, outraging and endearing the country in equal measure.
So you hurt me so, now I'm gonna pack my things and go.
Unlike the coy allusions to bisexuality of Bowie, Almond was a bit more forward in his presentation. There was something innocent about sexuality in the 80s. Back in the 70s, even lorry drivers liked the sweet, and you had this kind of flamboyance. Male peacocks, dandies, blending masculine and feminine. But it was all play acting. Even Boy George said he preferred a cup of tea to anything else, and he didn't really have a sexuality. So I think I came across as quite a threatening figure, quite aggressive. After Tainted Love got to number one, 80s Top of the Pops became host to all manner of more openly queer pop music, while setting up the next crop of pop provocateurs. Created by the producers of the television show Soul Train, US R&B collective Shalimar were climbing the charts in June 1982 with A Night to Remember. Two-thirds of the group were unavailable for the accompanying Top of the Pops performance, so guitarist Jeffrey Daniel flew to London solo and choreographed a dance routine that would leave Britain dumbstruck. The audience went crazy because they had never seen anything like it before. They had never seen body popping to begin with. To think of what the power of love can do. And they had never seen the backslide. People didn't know what was happening. They thought like I had wheels on my shoes. They thought there was oil on the floor. They did not know how in the hell I was walking forward and sliding backward at the same time. As well as making Shalimar one of the best-selling bands in the UK in 1982, Daniel would introduce the country to body popping, breakdancing, and US hip-hop culture in general, a genre that 80s Britain would latch upon.
Four Buffalo guys go around the outside, round the outside, round the outside.
Michael Jackson would also get Daniel to teach him the backslide, which he rebranded several months later at the Motown 25th anniversary show as the Moonwalk. In 1972, a young Johnny Marr's life was forever changed watching T-Rex perform Metal Guru on Top of the Pops. T-Rex were already my favourite group, and when I was 11 or 12, I saw them on Top of the Pops doing that track. It bordered on the mystical. I didn't know what to do, I was in total shock, and I just got on my push bike and rode until it was dark. I ended up miles away from home, not really knowing where I was, and all my family were really worried about me. When his band The Smiths played the show themselves, the first words out of the perennial focus Morrissey's mouth were, "Bicycle on a hillside desolate," which only adds to the cosmic alignment of the moment. This Charming Man was written by Marr as a response to Aztec Camera's cheery Walk Out to Winter. Walk out to winter, swear I'll be there. But Morrissey bled out lyrics of literary insight and ambiguous sexuality. Before appearing on the show, the Smiths were underground residents of the John Peel set, a no-one band with a jangle in their step. But afterwards, they were stars. Part of this was because of the gladioli of it all. Morrissey's broad gestures with a fistful of flowers, sending up the mandatory miming protocol, a microphone in hand being superfluous. I would go out tonight, but I haven't got the stitch to wear. Also note how Marr is standing stock still, so he doesn't slip on the petals and land on his arse on national TV. Morrissey was using those gladioli in a way that was far from fey, almost brandishing them. Morrissey provided flamboyance. The rest of us wore sweaters and provided a streetwise gang aspect. We'd had a year of rejections, getting in the trenches, Nothing had been handed to us on a plate, and we were ready. Though this charming man would only get to number 25, indie was now a music the charts understood. Kids too young or uncool to be aware of Peel Show or read NME were introduced to the world of guitar music in a sea of Hairspray and synths. Many picked up Rickenbackers of their own and formed bands, many of which also chimed their way onto the show.
What a good place to be, don't believe it.
When the Smiths came on Top of the Pops for the first time, that was it for me. From that day on, it was, I wouldn't say, yes, I probably would say, I wanted to be Johnny Marr. Such was the iconic nature of the Smiths on Top of the Pops, that even when Americans played the show, Morrissey was their go-to reference. Everyone knows Kurt Cobain's dour-voiced appearance for Smells Like Teen Spirit was him attempting to sound like the Manchester crooner. But a year later, the Lemonheads' Evan Dando did another spot-on impression at the end of Mrs. Robinson.
Now this is how it started. My dreams are broken-hearted, yet I want you.
When Love Can't Turn Around hit the UK top 20 in September 1986, the UK at large was oblivious to house music. Born in the black gay clubs of Chicago at the beginning of the 80s, DJs had boiled down disco to its absolute most danceable elements. A four-on-the-floor beat, a bass line, and an ultra-hype soul vocal on top. It was not made for the radio, but the club. The average Top of the Pops viewer knew nothing about that.
But when we get down to it, I just love the way you do it, and I love you.
Though they might have not understood how Farley Jack Master Funk had made this starkly kinetic music, an exuberant disco diva in the Loretta Holloway mold is a familiar calling point.
Love can't turn around.
Love can't turn around.
Love can't turn around.
Former Broadway and opera performer Daryl Pandy flamboyantly barreled across the stage as if his life depended on it, demanding the audience's attention. Pandy's histrionics are emblematic of the house scene in general. House is about the loss of decorum and control. From sexual extravagance to dance floor excess, everything about house is geared towards losing it. Several months later, Steve Silk Hurley's Jack Your Body would go number one. Before the homegrown collaboration Mars would repeat their achievement in September 1987 with the sample heavy Pump Up the Volume.
Pump up the volume, dance.
British producers then started creating their own club anthems. House and his Roland TB 303 squelching sibling, Acid House, would dominate the British airwaves by the start of the 1990s, and Pandy, glittering in turquoise, was Britain's first taste. Manchester had been bubbling away as a local occurrence and in the pages of the NME for a couple years by November 1989, but it boiled over when a bunch of addled working class scruffs called Happy Mondays and an oddly tuneful collision of 60s English rock and ecstasy known as the Stone Roses showed up on the same episode of Top of the Pops. Manchester has a dour and rainy reputation, unhelped by its history with Joy Division and Morrissey, but these bands brought a psychedelic splash of colour to their kinetic guitar music. The Mondays even managed to pull Kirsty MacColl on stage for their shambolic presentation of Hallelujah from their then number 30 charting Manchester Rave On EP. Despite this, viewers' attention was aimed at the band's mascot, the moon-eyed metronomic Bez, proving that all you needed to be part of the scene was a knee and a desire to dance. Remembered Monday's guitarist, Paul Ryder. I think everyone was heavily sedated. I vividly remember being sat in the BBC garden, and Sean Ryder and Ian Brown were chuckling, plotting to swap drummers. I think the BBC rumbled it. A couple months prior, the Roses' Ian Brown had heckled the BBC's Late Show team after their live run-through of Made of Stone was unceremoniously cut short by a power shortage.
He's exploiting his subjects rather than making social commentary.
Amateurs!
Here he soaks up the artificiality of the moment, making no pretense of miming to their number 13 entry, Fool's Gold. The microphone wielded akin to Morrissey's gladioli, nowhere near his mouth. But despite this, both bands' collisions of acid house and indie looked and sounded so cool, it made an assortment of British indie kids believe they too could dance.
You're unbelievable.
Britpop was seemingly designed for Top of the Pops. All the bands were looking back to the best of British, which coincidentally was the best of Top of the Pops. Suede had Bowie's flair and sexual ambiguity. Pulp's Jarvis Cocker had the wit of prime Morrissey. Blur were a greatest hits package of The Kinks, The Jam and Madness, while Oasis's best riffs were taken from T-Rex and Status Quo.
It had been like an indie scene. You were excited if you got in the NME. And then suddenly a wider culture took notice of it and bands were getting on Top of the Pops. Stuff that's been considered a bit alternative is now coming into the mainstream. Is there a revolution in the air? Oh, wouldn't that be nice?
Though Pulp's emblematic number two placing of Common People was 2 months prior. August 1985 was when Britpop hit fever pitch. Oasis had their next single, Roll With It, set for release. And Blur, feeling particularly tasty, moved the release of their Country House forward to the same week. It was a battle for number one that not just the music press, but the tabloids also leapt upon. A Beatles versus Stones for the 90s. Though neither band brought their best work to the fight, the surrounding press made it the best week for UK single sales in a decade, shifting 500,000 copies between them. In the end, Blur triumphed. Their End of the Pier, Damien Hirst directed music video, and variety of single formats, securing them a momentary win over their northern opposition. As Blur victoriously ambled their way through Country House, bassist Alex James further provoked their foes by wearing their merchandise.
I'm a professional silly, but my heart's not in it.
While guitarist Graham Coxon visibly wanted to be anywhere else but on stage. But given greater exposure due to this battle of Britpop, Oasis would go on to become the biggest band in Britain after second album What's the Story Morning Glory outsold God. While Blur would abandon their British influences for their 1997 self-titled album. However, it would end up being the last real hurrah for guitar music on Top of the Pops. The new NME revolution bands, who had seen Blur vs. Oasis play out as kids, would have their moment on the BBC stage in the early 2000s.
What can you want now? You've got it all up the seat. Is it seat that was to fade away?
But sadly, by this point, no one was really watching anymore. In June 1996, due to decreasing viewership, in a desperate move to course correct, the BBC shifted Top of the Pops from its traditional slot on Thursday evening to Friday, as it now conflicted with going out on Friday night, as well as the nation's favourite soap opera, Coronation Street. It would be the beginning of the end for the beloved music programme. But before it went, it would contribute one last truly important addition to British culture. In July 1996, the Spice Girls made their debut on Top of the Pops. On a promotional tour of Japan, the group had to satellite in, energetically miming their way through their boisterous introduction to the world, Wannabe, from a local Tokyo temple. If you wanna be my lover, you gotta get with my friends, make it last forever. Immediately, you could see the different personas, and Top of the Pop's official magazine would coin the nicknames that they would forevermore be known by: Scary, Sporty, Baby, Posh, and Ginger. Jerry, born a month after Bowie's seminal strum through Starman, replicated his moves, pointing knowingly at the audience, inviting them to Spice World. Get your act together, we could be just fine. Future artists who were young women at the time saw this and thought, yes, us too. I was exactly the target demographic for the Spice Girls when they came out. It's strange, now that I'm an adult, to see how something that, on one level, could be really empowering and exciting for young girls, was kinda all about selling shit. Inspired by this selling shit aspect, British pop producers cashed in by formulating their own personality-driven chart pop. The Spice Girls dominated the show for the rest of the 90s. Problem was that Top of the Pops wasn't the first place most people would have seen the Spice Girls. The music video was already a massive hit on British music video jukebox channel The Box, before Wannabe entered the singles chart. If you could get the latest music and see your favourite bands elsewhere on television and earlier, what was the point of Top of the Pops? As the show limped on for another decade, the BBC, blood on their hands, desperately tried to revive it with newer, shinier presenters and different, more confusing time slots. With first MTV and then the internet, music consuming habits had forever changed. It was awful by the end, like watching a goldfish out of its bowl flapping around the floor as it dies. But it was incredibly sad to see it go. Top of the Pops aired its last weekly episode in July 2006. Still, for most of the initial 42-year run that Top of the Pops was broadcast, it had an undeniable impact on the British public. Even today, Thursday night reruns of classic episodes on BBC Four still attract a sizable audience. Some of it is nostalgia, soured slightly by the actions of some of the personalities involved. But for many, watching Top of the Pops motivated them to learn an instrument and start a band. It made often neglected members of society feel seen, or introducing others to brand new genres. And it even made at least one little boy get so overexcited that they went out on their bike and got lost. Those Thursday nights were sacred, and British music wouldn't be the same without them. Thanks for watching. Obviously, this is my 12 most important. Bar there any Top of the Pops performances you think I missed? Comment down below. If you like this video, like, subscribe, and why don't you also do me a favor and share it with a couple of people? It really does help. As always, I'd like to shout out all my supporters over on Patreon. And I'll see you hopefully in 2 weeks' time for a return to New British Canon.